This is Right On by Final Draft. This is the podcast where we talk to screenwriters about screenwriting. Today, our guest is Andrew Bujalalsk. He is an independent filmmaker. You may know his work from Funny Ha Ha and Mutual Appreciation, but today we're here to talk about Support the Girls, his latest movie. Andrew Bujalalsk, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure. Thank you for having me.
So we'd like to start off with just a little bit about your background and how you got into storytelling, writing, filmmaking.
Well, I was just a movie crazy kid. As far back as I can remember, you know, 5 years old, I was begging my parents to take me to the movie, and they were all too indulgent. They took me to all kinds of stuff that, in retrospect, can't believe. I have kids now, and I'm not letting my kids watch Conan the Barbarian yet. It's ridiculously violent and gruesome. But I just spent a lot of time with those movies, and for better or worse, I never really thought about doing anything else with my life. I was pretty focused in that sense. And I went to college and studied film as an undergrad, and have kind of trudged along this path. I always admired the people who came from something else. You know, I think I like those stories, and I like a lot of the work of people who maybe did something else with their lives and then came around to cinema later, because they can often have a perspective that that those of us who spend our lives in dark rooms don't. But I was in it from the beginning.
How did you get started with your first film? How did you get started in general in the industry? What were your first jobs?
I had this undergrad film degree and no good idea of what to do with it. I think the first job I ever had out of college, I stumbled into teaching a high school film studies class. So all this stuff I just had my head filled with in college, I went and tried to impose on 14-year-olds. During that time, I was doing my own writing. I wrote a few handful of screenplays right out of college, and they weren't necessarily any good. But I think I was learning by doing. And a few years down the road from that, you know, I knew I wanted to make something. I didn't really know what that meant or how I would do it. But I was very lucky and grateful to have the background that I had as a film student. I went to Harvard, and they had a great film program. It's certainly not an industry focused film program. So they don't tell you anything about how to get a job or how to work in the industry. So all you know how to do is kind of make a film, and make a film in a very guerrilla sort of way. You know, it's all about here's how the camera works, here's how the sound works, here's how the Steenbeck works.
We're not thinking about how to get a sales agent and distribution. We're thinking about how to roll.
Yeah, exactly. And it's also not, you know, so here's what the key grip does. You know, it's not, you don't know any of that. It's just get, you know, as many of your classmates as you can pull together and try to make something. And so that's how I was thinking. That's how I've been taught. But again, I still didn't know what that meant. And I wrote the scripts that I wrote after college were, they could have gone in different directions, but I think I had it in my head that we're just going to go out and make something somehow. And I'd seen, you know, a few examples of people doing that existed for sure.
Yeah.
And finally I ended up writing the screenplay that became Funny Ha Ha. And I think the big breakthrough there was that at that time I was about 22 when I started writing that. Kate Dollenmeyer, who plays the lead role in that movie, was my roommate at the time. And she was and is one of the more charismatic humans I've ever met. So I got this idea in my head that maybe I should write something for her to play the lead in. And that notion seemed to make my writing better. I had a better sense of what I was doing and what I wanted to put on the screen when I could picture this real human doing it, you know, and somebody who was not a professional actor. I didn't really know if she'd be any good, but I don't know. I had an intuition in it, and it was enough to really pull me through that script and get me excited about trying to do it. And so, you know, there were some stumbles along the way, but then we ended up shooting, making that movie very guerrilla style with a, you know, small to non-existent crew. and then after we shot it, I no money and nothing to do with it. I moved into my mother's house again, and I got an old professor to lend me his Steenbeck, and I edited on his Steenbeck in my mom's house for however long that took, and finished the movie. And then, you know, that had a very long weird lifespan too, but eventually it kind of got out there, and that in some in some strange way sort of set me on this track and that I've been on ever since.
Well, let's get into that. How did it get out there? How did that happen?
I finished the movie. I remember standing there with and I finished a 16mm, so I had, you know, the first exhibition version of that movie was a 16mm print. And this was in 2002, and that was already pretty outdated. There weren't a lot of places that were, you know, that were eager to run your movie on 16. But there were a few. I remember holding the print in my hands and thinking, what am I supposed to do with this now? You know, I didn't have a whole lot of connections or sense of how exhibition worked. But there was a website, maybe it still exists, called filmfestivals.com, which was just kind of a list of every film festival and how their submission policies were. And I printed out a lot of submission forms, and I submitted to a lot of places and got rejected from almost all of them. What kind of broke it open for me was getting the support of a couple of critics. I was living in Boston at the time, and I got, you know, a VHS tape of the movie in the hands of a guy named Ray Carney, who taught at BU and was, you know, has written a lot of great books on Cassavetes and Mike Lee, et cetera, a lot of, you know, so many of the filmmakers who have been hugely inspirational to me. And we also got a tape in the hands of a guy named Gerald Perry, who years later went on to act in my movie Computer Chess. But he's a Boston critic as well. And the two of them really went to bat for me, and they helped. So the first screening of that movie, the first public screening of Funny Haha ever, was at the Coolidge Quarter Theater in Boston in a series that Jerry Perry was programming of local filmmakers. And from there, we went to a few festivals. And then it had this weird build. You know, it had this long lifespan where I kept thinking, after we went to two or three regional festivals, I thought, well, that's probably it. That's probably the end of that. But, you know, I'm glad we got it seen. And then it would just kind of keep getting invited to another and get, you know, something a little more high profile. And we played at the Los Angeles Film Festival and got reviewed in Variety. And that sort of, you know, put us on the L.A. radar. And so that's a movie that we finished in 2002. In 2005, a private investor who really wanted the movie to get out said to us, you know, well, how much – said to myself and the guy who was working as my sales rep at the time, who's since become a producer on most of my films, Houston King, he said, this investor said, how much money would it take for you guys to put it in theaters yourselves? And so we did that. We did it cheaply, but we got it out there. And that was a strange journey for that movie to be on the big screen on 35mm 3 years after we finished it. But it was also a great experience, you know, to something. It's very unlike what I'm doing now. I mean, I'm sitting here talking to you on my Support the Girls press tour for a movie that, you know, Magnolia is releasing on Friday, and it's going to come out in I don't know how many cities, and it's going to be on VOD. And so, you know, it's everybody who's going to a huge portion of the people who are going to see this movie are going to see it in the next, you know, 7 to 14 days. Which is kind of – that's how the business normally works. But it was – I wouldn't want to repeat it, but it was nice to do it the other way where you just – something just kind of floats along for 3 years.
That's amazing. So why would a private – this sounds like a total anomaly. Why would a private investor want to, you know, make sure that movie gets out that much later?
Because he is a generous and beautiful soul. You know, he's just a – he's a guy who obviously I love very much, but somebody who – he had seen the movie, I think an associate of his, and he's not a film industry guy. He's actually a music industry guy, but just a really, you know, again, a big hearted person who really cared about the movie and really wanted it to get out there. And that was kind of all there is to it. It was a textbook angel investor.
Wow. So not really looking for the, amazing return on investment, just looking.
No.
Yeah.
No.
Wow. That's great. Well, let's get into Support the Girls. So how did this movie come about? How did the writing come about? What was the idea?
You know, I think I stumbled into one of these highway side sports bar with curbs probably a decade or so ago. And I don't know what I was expecting from it, but something about it surprised me and stuck with me. I found it so peculiar and so funny in a way, and certainly uniquely American. I couldn't imagine any other culture in history that would produce the demand for this kind of place. That, you know, because obviously there's a and these are all these restaurants that are kind of descended from Hooters. I think Hooters invented this concept in 1980 something, but then maybe 15 or 20 years ago there was an explosion of these other chains that took the same idea and, you know, maybe tried to update it or tweak it one way or another, and there are a bunch of them, but they all have this kind of, you know, little kernel of raunchiness that's of course part of what they're selling. But then when you go in there, it really does not feel particularly raunchy at all, and that's what surprised me or interested me, is that there's so much about comfort and there's so much about selling a feeling of kind of normalcy and acceptance. And, you know, and they all build themselves as family places. They all say, bring grandma, bring the kids. And so there are all these weird little contradictions in that I found fascinating. And I don't know how you would tell a story about this, but it stuck in my head. And I just kind of kept coming back to it over the years. At one point I had pitched a TV version of this idea, which in retrospect, I'm glad never came together, because I always have trouble. TV is not intuitive to me, because for me, it's very hard to tell a story if I'm not allowed to end it. and so, you know, when it didn't get picked up as a TV thing, I put it aside, but some years later, it was just still in my head, so I dusted it off again, and then I thought, well, maybe is there a feature version of this where I get to have an ending, and then does that help me kind of crack this story? And went forward from there.
What happens next? I mean, how do you start writing this?
You know, I procrastinate and I eat everything in the fridge, and eventually I'm so disgusted with myself that I open up the computer and put something down. Never know how to start on something, but I did because there had been this thinking through the TV version of it. I had a lot of material to jump off from. You know, I could go back to, and I could look at all the notes I had written about that and say, you know, what from this is still interesting to me? What do I want to use? What should I dump? But it had always been about this general manager character, this Lisa character. She had always been central in my conception of this. So, and that was something where, you know, whereas in a TV world, it probably would have been even more about it's a big ensemble cast in this movie, and it's definitely an ensemble movie, but it's an ensemble movie that really pivots around this one character. You know, she is for sure the center of gravity in this, in a way that maybe, you know, she would not have been quite so much if this was a story that had to go on for hours and hours. I'm sure there would have been more, you know, going home with everybody else. But that was the first thing, was going, okay, well, now I can really just let me try to center everything on Lisa. Let me let this be Lisa's movie and let everybody orbit around her, and went from there. Which is tricky as a writer, because you're shutting off a lot of avenues. You know, when you say, okay, I can't really cut away from this person. Even for little practical things, you know, even for exposition, you're like, well, you know, any exposition that happens has to happen when she's in the room, and that creates its own set of challenges.
So let's talk about Lisa, the general manager. She is the central character to some extent, even though it is an ensemble. I totally feel that. What was important about her? How did that begin to form? And how, I mean, there are certain qualities. There's a great example I'd like to get to of what she needs versus what she wants. And she's a great character to talk about that stuff. So how did that form for you?
You know, I think I'm always fascinated by the incurable optimist character. It's a kind of personality type that I think I'm drawn to in life, but certainly as a writer, I like those people who insist on seeing the best in a situation and trying to make the best out of a situation, even when everything conspires against them, even when the situation is clearly not so great. And that was always kind of my way into this story. And I say this more, you know, in retrospect, it's not necessarily a conscious process at the time, but I think I was bringing an outsider's perspective to this world because I had to. I've certainly never worked in one of these places. and nor am I really the target market. You know, I went to a bunch of them when I was researching, but I'm not the guy who's in there for lunch every day. So I knew I couldn't bring either of those perspectives. But if I had an outsider character, if I had somebody who, you know, Lisa doesn't necessarily quote unquote belong there either, and would not be there if not for it being her paycheck. But she insists on making the best of it, and she finds a lot to love. I mean, that was the appeal of that character to me. You know, she's certainly not a cynic. She's not someone who comes in and says this place is gross, and you know, on the occasions when it is gross, she can still look past that and see some beating heart in there. And that was very appealing to me. And that was, for me, there was a lot of story that to come from that. And really, that is the basis for everything that happens in this movie, is that it's almost entirely the story of an optimist battling against reality.
Yeah, I mean, she takes it upon herself. She makes it her responsibility to help everyone, mm-hmm. large and small, all around her.
Yeah, and it often blows up in her face. But to me, that's maybe almost kind of the central philosophical question of the movie too, is what is the value of that? You know, if you try to do good in the world and you try to bring light and it doesn't always work, then does that mean you shouldn't have done it, or is there still a value? I think that's probably something that most people one way or another can relate to. I think, you know, everyone's had experience with what they thought were good intentions leading somewhere not so good.
Right, and that's sort of the center of the movie.
Yeah.
All right, so let's talk about the ensemble cast around her. How did those characters form? I mean, there's a balance between everybody that you have to achieve. You know, not too many characters in one direction. So how do you spread those out and get that variety of feeling and tone from people?
Yeah, I don't know. It's kind of just a lot of ideas about... I think one thing that interested me about the place is that it is a concept, you know. I mean, all it is a concept. It's just an idea of a restaurant, you know, and everybody has a kind of different notion of what everybody bounces off that in a different way. You know, I have my read on what's being sold in there, but somebody else might see it a little different. And so I guess I wanted to take that, all these different approaches to that idea of this restaurant, and refracted through all these different characters. So, and I was aware too that, you know, no two people in there have the same story. So, you know, there's a pretty clear dichotomy of these, the two main waitresses, Lisa's most beloved lieutenants in there, Macy and Danielle, I think have very different feelings about their work, approaches to their work. They're both really good at their job. In the case of Macy, she's someone who I think is very much of that culture, mm-hmm. and someone to whom that job makes a lot of sense. You know, that somebody who enjoys working there, whereas Danielle, I think, has certainly more a kind of cerebral approach to her. It's more of a performance for her, and for her, it is a paycheck. It's a slightly better paycheck than she would be getting at Chili's.
Right.
But she makes a performance of it, but you see the face kind of turn on and turn off, you know. I mean, she does it when it's necessary, and it's probably not unlike, you know, I'm sure there's a parallel to be made with actors, you know, that some of them go deep, and some of them are just come at it as an expression of something perfectly natural within, and then others turn it on and turn it off. And it's everybody has a different approach, and so I just wanted to reflect that in the people.
Yeah, for sure. And they like I said, they come off as very different people, lots of different perspectives.
Yeah.
All right. So here's a challenge that I think the movie accomplishes well. But I mean, this I hope I'm not saying anything that you wouldn't agree with here, but the restaurant itself, at least the restaurant concept in reality, is certainly sexist on any level I would see. But the film is not. And I think that's hard to achieve because there is some sexism here, but we're not taking that perspective as an audience. The film is not exploiting people. It's talking about a world that does sort of exploit people.
I certainly did not want the movie to be judgmental. You know, I had no interest in making a kind of polemic about these terrible places.
Yeah.
They're real places where real people work. Mm-hmm. You know, and they all have different perspectives. As I said, I mean, I think, you know, a character like Danielle might agree with you and say this place is sexist and nasty, and mm-hmm. I do it because I have to make a living. And a character like Macy might say, I don't know, the people are nice. You know, I mean, I don't want to reject any perspective out of hand. I wanted to try to take it on its own terms as much as I could. So my feeling, you know, whether I'm making this movie or a movie about a computer chess tournament or whatever, is I guess it's the only way I know how to approach character is to try to do my best to understand where people are coming from and what circumstances are dealt to them. You know, it's not something that we have a whole lot of control over in our own lives, what culture we're born into or thrust into. But for me, it's always just about trying to meet people where they are to the best of my ability.
Yeah, I think that was a nice line to walk, honestly, because this movie isn't about its sexuality, and you're right, it isn't about poking at that sort of life or that sort of restaurant. It's about these people.
Yeah, and if we're doing our jobs, then we're doing that as respectfully and seriously as we can, which is not to say, you know, without humor or without warmth, but trying not to lose sight of the fact that these, you know, we're inventing them, they're fictional people, but they have to have some relationship to these real people.
What do you learn while you're directing this? What do you learn on set about the story? How do things change?
Oh, everything changes all the time. I mean, it's directing. I think the most successful directors I know are people who really, really love the adrenaline of that. And I wish I were one of those people. I find directing to, I'm the biggest complainer on set. And I'm always, you know, whining about how exhausting and draining it is, but it's also quite magical and marvelous. And you know, there's a huge value to the fact that you don't get to stop and think. And I've been very, very, very lucky to have, made six features now, which nobody's necessarily, there's nobody holding the purse saying you can't do this. You know, I've had extraordinary creative control in this. So that means I'm there, I'm writing, the first four movies I edited myself, the last two I've been in the room with brilliant editors. And so you have a lot of time to think when you're writing and a lot of time to think when you're editing, and when you're directing, you don't. it's a sprint in the middle of the marathon. And that's kind of great. You know, think great things come from that, that you wouldn't, you get backed into corners and you're forced to figure things out on the fly. And very often you get wonders out of that, that you probably wouldn't if you had more time to think about it.
Yeah, you're right. I mean, that's a great analogy I've never heard before. The sprint in the middle of the marathon. Mm. You just don't have that time.
Yeah. No, it's but that's also, I mean, that's cinema, you know. That's where all the magical stuff happens.
Right. That's the feeling and reaction and instinct. Mm-hmm. So let's move on to the less creative parts, but can you talk about how the movie really came together? Like who, you know, I know Magnolia is involved at this point, but when did all of those other people and all those partners and collaborators, distributors, how did that all come together? When?
Houston King is a producer I've been working with for a long time. So I think most ideas I have, I start by calling him up and chatting with him. The Burn Later guys, Sam Slater and Paul Bernan, were producers who we'd worked with on Results. We'd had a good experience with them. We got along with them and felt very comfortable with them. So, So, you know, I went to this, went to them with this idea first. They, thank goodness they paid me to write it, which was a great leap of faith on their part. But also, you know, that gave me some room to breathe and not freak out about money for a few months. Mm-hmm. And we, you know, we went from there, and things, it's always a bumpy road, you know, and anytime you make an indie movie or low budget movie, it could all fall apart at any moment. I hate that part. I hate the part where you're sitting by the phone going like, I'm either doing a huge project, you know, a month from now or not.
Right.
It's very hard to, you know, think about your life with that kind of sword of Damocles over your head. But you know, it came together. We pulled it off, and there's not a lot of story to tell because it was pretty undramatic. You know, that's the good news, is that it was mostly people who just wanted to try to make this thing happen, all working together and doing it.
How's that different from the other movies that have come before, where you didn't have all those resources and didn't have all that team around you at that point?
No matter what you're doing, no matter how small you make it, it's still it wouldn't take much. You know, it would just take a strong wind to knock it all over. the only real difference is that as the budgets go up, and it's still, of course, very modest by professional filmmaking standards. This Support the Girls was the biggest budget I've worked with, but you know, I'm sitting here in like a fancy hotel in Hollywood doing this press stuff, and I'm aware of how much money flows through this town.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, there's this kind of other layer that gets added in when you're dealing with. I started out making movies with all non-professional actors. So if you had a question or a concern for those people, you would just call them and ask them.
Hmm.
And now there's, you know, of course there's this layers of reps, and there's this layer, and you get into money, and then there's lawyers. There's all that stuff, mm-hmm. which just becomes another layer you have to work through. But again, as long as everybody's, I mean, the nice thing about making movies like this that are relatively small is that, you know, certainly everybody is well aware that this is not going to be the thing to make them wealthy. So it's pretty self-selecting. You know, most people don't show up, actors, producers, whoever, most people don't show up if they don't care about the project and the ideas and what you're going for. So that's what moves it along, ultimately, is just people's investment in it.
Yeah, I mean, their emotional investment in it, and that's the most important thing, to get people involved and passionate.
Mm-hmm.
So how did you get started with casting? Did you wind up going through casting directors? Did you start to talk to people you knew?
Yeah, well, we eventually brought casting directors on, but for the early part of it, where, I mean, we knew this whole thing lived and died by a lead.
Mm-hmm.
So there was kind of, you know, there was nothing else to talk about if we didn't have somebody to play Lisa, and somebody who we were excited about, who we were all excited about. So Regina's name came up pretty early, and I knew some of her work. I think, you know, I'd seen all the scary movies, or no, sorry, not all of them. There's a lot of them. I'd seen the first few. You know, I knew some of her stuff. I didn't know all of it, because she's a really hard hustling actor who's got a ton of credits. But I was intrigued by her, and you know, and the producers I knew were excited about her. So I went and got a meeting with her. We were lucky enough to get her attention. I went down to New Orleans. She was just wrapping Girls Trip. And we sat and, you know, over coffee for 90 some minutes, we chatted about the script, and it was just exciting. There's this kind of alchemical thing that happens, where, you know, the director brain turns on. And as you talk to somebody, you start to imagine, I start to imagine Regina's voice within Lisa's voice, and Lisa's voice within Regina's voice. And, you know, there's certainly, Regina is certainly very different from this character, but I could start to imagine some of the energy she had just at the table at this cafe.
Wow.
And the character, you know, and I could start to, you start to feel that, and you go, okay, this begins to tell me how this movie might feel. And that was really exciting. You know, you go down the road, and it's still nerve-wracking, because especially with this role in this movie, where Regina carries everything. You know, she is in most shots of the movie,
right.
And also it's a really difficult part for an actor to the extent that I felt like I was often apologizing to Regina, because it's not, you know, she's rarely just playing one clear note. It's usually like Lisa's thinking about these 10 things and, but also repressing all these feelings and trying to project this, you know, it's not an easy part to find your way through. There are all these weird little twists and turns in it. But she's an incredibly charming person. She's also an incredibly hardworking actor, and both those things, served this movie very well, and I feel very lucky to have benefited from that.
Yeah, so do we as an audience. Definitely benefited from that. So let's go back in time for our last question, and what would be the advice that you would give to Andrew back before he made Funny Ha Ha? What that you know now would you impart to that guy?
It would probably have nothing to do with filmmaking. It would be like about the haircut and, you know, stuff like that. As far as filmmaking goes, I wouldn't say a word to that guy, because that was an incredible freedom I had at that time. The freedom to make a movie without knowing anything about who would ever see it was quite extraordinary. And I think in a way it's the kind of, you know, it's a kind of platonic ideal that I'm always trying to rush toward in my head. In a way, anytime I sit down to write, I'm doing my best to forget anything I know about the movie business and just go back to that place of, as Willy Wonka would say, pure imagination.
Yes, he would say that. Andrew, that is a great place to leave it off for us. Thank you so much for doing this with us.
Thank you.
And thank you out there for listening to this podcast. And also thank all of you who have been leaving ratings and review on iTunes. That helps us a lot and helps people find the podcast. So keep doing that. And until next time, right on.